everyone, and welcome to the Stoa. The Stoa, as you all know, is a digital campfire where we can hear and dialogue about what matters most at knife's edge of what's happening now. Or, as we've been saying lately, simply, welcome to the Stoa. And for those of you here today, I guess you already know what it is. But for those of you who don't know me, I'm Rebecca Fox, and I'm a ritualist now, apparently. And that has a lot to do with the Stoa and with this space that Peter's created. And I'm sure this is true for everyone. I found something that maybe might become my vocation here, but I think we've all had this same experience in different ways over the last 3 years, through the conversations we've shared, the practices, the ideas we've opened, or I'll speak for myself, but I'm pretty sure I speak for everyone. I say we've opened up rooms inside ourselves, new ways of being, new possibilities of what we can be and what we can become. And we've done that by making connections between thoughts and experiences and between people. I know I feel like a completely different person than I did in the autumn of 2019 when I first met Peter in Athens. We were attending a Stoic conference, and it was that mingling time you have at conferences. And I said to my friend who was standing with, oh, it's going to be another one of those conferences where I don't speak to anyone apart from the people I came in with, just this little group of British people all just talking to each other. But he'd spent the weekend trying to chat up women. So he was completely relaxed about the idea of approaching a new person. So he said, have no fear, turned around and introduced himself and me to the first person he saw, and that was Peter. And he'd just given a talk on how to build a modern Stoa. And I wasn't at that talk. Wait a minute, let me just check my program. Let's see. I was at something else. What was it? There we go. Can I share my screen with you guys? Yeah, there we go. Okay. I think I was at Stoicism and Creativity, or perhaps I was on this, to be honest, slightly boring thing on Epictetus down at the bottom. But I missed Peter's talk anyway. But it turns out that talk, as we all now know, was prophetic, because in that next spring, he started the Stoa, and we all are where we are today because of it. So if you've got one, I'm going to ask you now to light a candle and think about that thing that is the Stoa. And it's different things to all of us, this strange egregore we've created between us. I can't even express in words exactly what it is to me, but I can express it in a lighter and a candle. So I'm going to grab the candle off my working altar here and light it up for you guys, and I suggest you all do the same. This is the Stoa, at least in its current form, and each of you hold it too in your hands as we speak. I'm going to ask you to just leave that burning throughout the course of this talk. And since this is the last session, at least the last of this kind of session, I'm going to finish it up with a little ritual. We're all going to come together and come back around to our candles at the end. But for now, I'm going to pass this over to Peter and we'll get started. So thank you.
Beautiful. Thanks so much for Rebecca. I'm going to share my screen. And thank you, everyone, for coming today for the last public digital Stoa session, breathing into presence. And as Rebecca mentioned, the reason why I asked her to speak today was because we met at StoaCon in, was it November 2019, when it was October 2019. And this was before, 6 months before the Stoa was actually born, before the COVID pandemic. I had no idea I was going to create the Stoa. So it felt like a spell was cast at this presentation. And Rebecca has all sorts of magic up her sleeve, so felt appropriate to have her here today and open and close us off. So the Stoa, let me just move something in my way. Okay, so quick recap. If you want the full history, you can watch the Wisdom Commons presentations that I recently did on the YouTube channel. If you're watching this on YouTube, I'll link that in the show notes. And the thing about the Stoa, it's always ending. You know, it's always ending, but it's always just beginning. So the Stoa is not going to end. It's just going to transform. And you can follow the Less Foolish Substack, which I'll also put on the show notes for how it's going to evolve. But it was born 3.5 years ago in March 2020. It was based in the spirit of the gift economy. And it genuinely felt like I was creating in a way and just giving my gift. During peak lockdowns, I was averaging 40 events a week. And the thing that we're going to highlight today is a decentralized wisdom gym formed. And it was formed based on trust, really. There's no money that was transferred. It was no contracts. It was like a daemonic contract. I just kind of felt into the essence of people. And then we just kind of trusted each other. It's like that, my favorite Hemingway quote. If you want to find out if someone's trustworthy, trust them. That's what happened here at the Stoa. This collective gift giving emerged. And two people I want to highlight is Steve Beattie. I met Steve, I can't remember, maybe 2018, 2019. He did a wonderful presentation at the StoaCon conference I hosted. He did a bunch of in-person Wim Hof type breathing sessions. And then when the Stoa started, I reached out to him and said, hey, do you want to do a session? And then this idea of the Stoic breath emerged. And Steve has been doing this every Sunday. That's the official Stoa one, but then there was multiple ones since the Stoa began. And now it's definitely its own entity, its own thing, the Stoic breath. But just knowing Steve was there every Sunday, just breathing life into the Stoa, it just felt really reassuring. So I just want to give like a heartfelt thanks to Steve. Thank you, my friend. Send you lots of love for doing what you do and continuing doing what you do. And the other person is Ria Baeck. And it's funny, like I wanted to reach out to Ria. Like, I heard about her through Richard Bartlett. And he was talking a lot about her work. And I was kind of intimidated. I'm like, what is this collective presencing stuff? It was just kind of like, I was drawn to it, but you know, I didn't feel like I deserved to reach out. And it was weird synchronicity, because just when I was thinking about reaching out to her, she emailed me. And so there's just like something going on with the Stoa. And I don't know exactly what that email said, but it felt like Ria felt what I was feeling. And then I reached out, we jumped on a Zoom call. And then collective presencing sessions happening at the Stoa every Friday, twice now, and Tuesdays as well. And again, just like Steve breathing breath into the Stoa, Ria is really holding space for the presence to emerge. And so just knowing that it was happening three times a week was just a beautiful thing. So thank you so much for holding the presence down here at the Stoa. And both the Stoic breath and collective presencing will live on outside the Stoa. So I just wanted to give my heartfelt thanks, and feel to give some love in the chat as well. And this love extends to all the past hosts at Stoa that had their own series, AJ Bond, Shame Breakthrough Bootcamp, Daniel Kazanjian, the Metagame Mastermind, Benita Roy, the Psychotechnology Playground. It was sort of morphed into the pop-up school. Rebecca Fox, Ritual Studio, Raven Connolly's Socratic Speed Dating, and Skylar Brown, Embodiment Hour. And it was so beautiful just trusting them, giving their gift, hosting these sessions, and just having this wonderful community, just decentralized wisdom gym happening. So again, thank you. Give lots of love to these wonderful hosts, because this is basically what the Stoa is. And today, what we're going to do, I'm going to take and Steve in a moment, and he's going to get some breath on, breath work on. It's going to be 20 minutes, I believe. And then Steve's going to take in Ria, and we're going to have a collective presencing session for about 45, 60 minutes. And how that's going to work, there's going to be 8 past Stoa hosts that are going to be spotlighted, and everyone's going to be witnessing it, the conversation. And I'll explain that in a moment. And then Rebecca Fox is going to have about a 10-minute ritual at the end. And the vibe is going to be relaxed. It's going to be low-key. There's going to be like no crying, like maybe in the Stoa party that we had a couple of years ago. And it'll be roughly 2 hours, give or take. Come and go as you please, and keep the chats warm. And here are the people that's going to be in the collective presencing portion. So we got AJ Bond, Ria, Nick Shore, who's holding space for collective presencing as well, Benita, Rebecca Fox, Steve, Skylar. And the living question, which Ria will mention again, is how can we create a culture of inquiry that helps people navigate the complexities of life? Which is the provisional living question that I am running with at Less Foolish, which is the new project. So that being said, everyone get ready, because the breath is coming into the Stoa, and I'm taking you and Steve.
Welcome, everyone. So good to see some familiar faces here. I'm going to share my screen now. Actually, I'm not going to share my screen. I'm just going to share my noise. And hopefully you can hear that. Creeping in nice and quietly. If you're still holding your candle in your hands, put it down. We don't need to be holding candles right now. In fact, even move it away out of arm's reach. Many of you have done the Stoic breath with me, or many of you have done Wim Hof style breathing or some sort of breath work. If you haven't done any breath work, I'm confident that you have been breathing for much of your life now. And that's all we're going to do. So we're going to find yourself in a comfortable place. Now, if you happen to be driving your car or riding your bicycle or something like that, just listen. Don't do breath work. Make sure you're in a safe, comfortable place. You can be sitting on the floor, or lying down on a bed, or sitting in a comfortable chair. As you do breath work, things change. You start to drift out of this big head of yours, away from the thinky part. You drop down into your body. Sometimes as we drop out of the head, we forget that we're supposed to be sitting or holding on to something. We can fall over. Make sure you're safe. And we're just going to breathe. And in time, as the music changes, your breath will change. And begin to take deeper and steadier breaths, fully in and out. And the rhythm will change again, and that breath rhythm will become faster and faster and faster. And pretty soon, you won't know where you are. That's the point. We're going to have some breath holds. A time when you're going to let go of your breath, let all the energy fall away from your body, and you'll just stop breathing. It's in that moment, the silent space at the bottom of your breath, you get a rush of awareness. You're fully present in this moment. There's no past, there's no future. It's just you, yourself. We're going to start by just relaxing into your body right now. And I want you to take a hand, place your fingertips over your sternum, somewhere over your heart. Gently move your hand up and down your sternum. Just feel that contact. Bring your awareness to this touch of your body. If you want, you can gently tap. Gentle tap on your sternum. Then rest. Rest your hands in your lap. Close your eyes. Breathing through your nose, take a long, slow breath in. Just a comfortable breath, and at the top, just stop and hold, but hold in your lungs. Relax your body. Hold in your lungs. And then with a sigh or a hum, let your breath go. And we're going to do that again. Long, slow breath in through your nose. Gentle hold. You relax your body, hold in your lungs. And sigh or chant or hum all the way down. You're the type who feels a little self-conscious about making a noise. All the microphones are locked on mute. Don't worry about it. And again, slowly in through your nose. A relaxed hold. And a sigh, a hum, a chant all the way down. And feel that vibration in your throat. And we'll take this a little deeper. Long, slow breath in through your nose. A relaxed hold in your lungs, and now through your mouth, a sip of air. And a hold, and feel a pressure inside of you. And with a tone, breathe all the way out. Bringing that vibration down into your heart, an awareness in your body. One more time like that. In through your nose. Relaxed hold. A sip of air. And a tone. Down into your heart. Down to your plexus. Down to your sacrum. Down to your roots. Connect with your root. And breathe deeply in. At the top of your breath, simply let go. Deeply in. Deep, slow breaths. Breathing through your nose or your mouth. As you can with ease and let it fall away with a tone. As soon as that breath is gone, draw it back in. Deep, slow breaths. Nose or mouth. Draw this breath down to your roots. Down to the deepest part of your body, all the way down, filling your body, your breath rising from your roots, rising to your crown, and releasing. All your awareness is on this breath, the rush of air into your body, a gentle release, a wave of energy rising within you. Rippling through you with every exhalation. Fully in and let it go. Deep, slow breaths. Easy and relaxed, as deep as you can. Begin to feel a tingling in your body. in your fingers. Tingling rising through your hands and your arms. Perhaps a numbness around your nose and mouth. Breathe deeply in and out. You feel comfortable. You feel safe. You're in control of this breath. You're in control of you. Deeply in and let go. Let your voice vibrate. The hum with a tone, with a sacred chant of Om. The energy vibrate through your body. You're out of your head. You follow this breath. Rising and releasing. Rush of energy. If your body feels called to move, let it move. If you feel self-conscious, just turn off your camera and breathe in and out. Let your breath take over. Become your breath. Deeply in and out. You feel emotions rising in your heart. A laughter. A sob. Let it go. You're free to release. You're free to be. Few more breaths. Breathe deeply in. Hold in your lungs. Relax your body. A sip of air. And a tone all the way down. All the way down. Squeeze this breath from your body. Full exhale down to the bottom. And one more breath. Deeply in. Hold in your lungs as you relax. A sip of air, a hold, tightening in your chest, and let go, and stop. You simply stop without breath. All your awareness, all your focus turns inwards. Feel into your body. Sense the energy within. A tingle, a shiver. Open your mind. Without expectations, without labels. An open curiosity to all that you're feeling within you. It's a story that flows through your DNA. A story without words. Your truth that lies buried deep within. Open yourself to receive the story, to connect with the truth. Hold your breath. This time squeeze from your root. Squeeze through your belly. Squeeze through your chest. Roll your eyes up in your head. Squeeze your hands into fists. Squeeze your jaw. And as loud as you can. As loud as you dare. Breathe fully out. Deeply in. Hold. Squeeze. And let it go. Feel the rhythm. Feel the beats. Breathe with the rhythm. In, two, three, four. Out, two, three, four. In, two, three, four. Out, two, three, four. In, two, three, four. Out. In. Out. Connected breath. Circular rhythm. We breathe together. We share this breath. In. Out. In. Out. Out of your head. And breathe deeply in. A hold in your lungs as you relax. Fully relax. And a sigh. Sip of air. Breathe all the way down. All the way down. A purge of breath. Purge of energy. Deeply in. Time. What do you feel in its breath hold? A pulse, an awareness of self. Let your breath go. Feel into your body, fully relaxed, becoming aware of the tension points within you, a tightness, tingling sensation, an open curiosity. That voice inside your head, simply ask, who are you? Who are you? Open yourself to receive. Knowledge, transference, connection to the story without words, the myth that is alive within you. Who are you? Flows through your body, open to receive, gentle wave of breath carrying you deeper within. Of parts, who are we? The parts of self. Who am I? Open your heart and receive all that you are. Fully accept all these parts. Curiosity to get to know yourself. Deep breath in. A big sigh of good feelings. Wiggle your fingers. Move your hands and feet. Deep breath. Stretch as you come back into yourself. Back into your body. As you come back to this time and this place. Come back to this community. The shared experience. A shared presence. Thank you. believe I'll pass the candle over to you, Ria.
As we slowly, step by step, move into dialogue space, there's the invitation to stay as much as we can to that sense of being deeply rooted, being connected with our breath. Dialogue doesn't mean we enter only conceptual space. We enter a fully embodied sharing. At least that's what we're trying to do. Most of you are familiar with the practice of collective presencing, and I'm only going to name the little tool of using a talking piece, which is the mute and unmute button here. And I'm introducing the question again, that Peter shared, and see if you can receive it in that full embodied sense that we got through that reading exercise. How do we create a culture of inquiry that helps people navigate the complexities of life? And I'm going to offer a few adapted versions of this question, like, how do we live a culture of inquiry right now? How do we live a culture of inquiry that helps me and you to navigate the complexities of life? And the invitation in this exchange, in this generative dialogue, in this probably maybe slow exchange, the invitation is, can we even move below or underneath the assumptions that are in this question? There's a few of a culture of inquiry will help people navigate. What's even underneath that? And the how question is not so much about, let's exchange what we already know about it, but more an invitation to, how do we do it now, here, now, with these 8 people here in the middle? And I'm wondering if we might end up, of course, not with a plan or even a solution, but maybe we end with some kind of new questions formulated out of the exchange we have. So as we say, put the talking piece in the middle, like imagine we are in a circle talking pieces in the middle and anyone can pick it up when you feel called to share, to speak something that's related with this question somehow, and that's alive now in that fully embodied space that we are. So with that, I close my mic and I put the talking piece in the middle, and it probably has like an hour, and then we will move into the end ritual with Rebecca. So peace is in the middle.
What has come up for me as you were speaking was not so much how do we live a life of inquiry or curiosity, but how to live a life. And that we live in relation to others. We don't live in a silo. And to be in relation of curiosity of the other will allow us to be curious about life and ourselves. And so to expand and to live with others and to be seen and to see others is what's very much alive for me in this moment. I'll put the talking stick back in the center.
That note intuitively felt to pull this book up, Joseph Pieper, Abusive Language, Abusive Power. And to riff off what Steve just said, I agree with that fully, and it's in relationship. But it feels like there's a certain aspect of relationship, a truthful relationship. And Pieper, he talks about a lie. He says, a lie is the opposite of communication. It means specifically to withhold the other's share and portion of reality, to prevent his participation in reality. And so corruption of the relationship to reality and the corruption of communication. And then he goes on to say, whoever speaks to another person, not simply, we presume, in spontaneous conversation, but using well-considered words, and whoever in doing so is explicitly not committed to the truth, whoever, in other words, is in this guided by something other than the truth, such a person from that moment on no longer considers the other as a partner, an equal. In fact, he no longer respects the other as a human person. From that moment on, to be precise, all conversation ceases, all dialogue and all communication come to an end. And there's something like about inquiry for me, like especially philosophical inquiry, like the foundation is truthfulness, speaking what you believe to be true. And when I don't know what is true, which is often the case, I allow the spirit of truth to speak through me. And so that's what I'm betting on. And there's something dangerous about that because you don't know what's going to come out of you. You know, you don't know what's alive, or the content of the aliveness. And there's some things that hold me back, the record button right now. You know, I feel it. I'm like, ooh, okay, there's certain things that just can't come out right now. The level of intimacy that we have, like I don't want to burden someone with something. But there is something very beautiful about allowing the spirit of truth to speak through you, especially when you don't know what's going on, because it's like carving like that sacred real estate just a little bit more. Even if it's just saying, I don't know, which is often the case. And for me to build that muscle in relationship with someone else is basically what I'm dedicated towards right now. Yeah, so that's my piece, and I put the piece back in the middle.
I'll pick up the piece to say that what's alive for me is how do we build a culture of honesty? That's what comes up after your share, Peter, more than inquiry. Unless inquiry could be a seeing into honesty, something like that. Maybe that's what the word inquiry means. I'm not entirely sure even. But for me, the biggest hurdles to honesty are stories about what will hurt others and thereby hurt me through having hurt them. So something about like safety and courage is coming to mind for a culture of honesty. Put the piece back.
I want to deepen the inquiry here. Because so far we've been talking about interpersonal dialogue, but we live a lie. The lie that we can keep on living this way and things will be all right. And then we can be honest. I mean, we live our basic, we think we live in culture, like it's a system that we're conditioned by, rather than seeing culture in every act we take. I can be perfectly honest with you about what I believe and live in the lie called capitalism. So I think that, yeah, that's what's coming up for me, this deeper sense of living a lie.
I'd like to jump in there. I was feeling something similar. What was coming up for me was humility. Because it's like a joke how often I think I know what's going on, actually. And just recently I got hit hard by one of those. It's like every time a veil falls, I see how little I was seeing before. And it's a very, very humbling experience, and it makes me question all of my assumptions and presumptions. And then at the same time, because there's a tendency in that moment to go, well, for me, completely porous, or completely to get very lost, like it's all a lie and I'm completely without navigation, without tools. Who can I trust? What can I trust? And so then I have to kind of look for the thing, or the center, or the part that I do know. And it's not always easy to find. And so that brings me to community. And I don't just mean human community. I mean like being reflected back to myself by others and by like all of you right here, right now. And then also my environment. You know, the animals are really good at that. The plants are really good at that. And I'm in this constant dialogue with my environment and constantly not knowing what's going on, and then reorienting is how it feels to me. And I'm not even sure about that. Thank you. Peace back.
I'll pick up the stick. I'll share an image that's been with me since the beginning. It's still here. It's sort of present for me in the spaces. I don't know what it means really, but it's penguins, you know, when penguins all huddle together in a circle, like, I guess when winter's coming, I've seen that documentary, I think, about it. That image is really strong here, like, for me, in the space, that way it moves in a circle like that. And then I think the penguins cycle through, and the middle is warmest and the outside is coldest, like that, something like that. And it's like a never-ending movement like this. And at some point, your turn is to be on the outside, freezing your ass off. And at some point, you're in the middle and you're like, I'm quite warm now. And there's always bodies around me. And it's everybody's job to go to the edge like that, the cold edge, and risk death or something like that. It's very present. I can almost, at one moment when somebody was speaking, I could almost feel like penguin bodies against me or something like that. And then the cold edge. And you can see, I guess when you're in the middle, all you can see is penguins. And when you're on the outside, you can see that how scary it is, the mountain and the edge and the ice and the nothingness for miles or something. It's present for me. Just stick down.
Stand up. Although I'm a therapist since many years, I've recently, in this experiment of living this culture within collective presencing, network and community, realizing how diverse the inner lives are of other people. And it's not just the complexities of life out there. But even when we try to do our utmost best, let's say, to respect, to honor, to be transparent, to be honest, all these good intentions of being with one another, how complex it is, how to navigate, to honor everyone, let's say, to honor every complex nuance people have in their inner life, which I could never even think of. And there's some sadness somehow. It would be so nice that we all could flourish, that the life force, that energy that we were sensing or invited to sense by Steve, yeah, if that could move more freely in more of us. I think there's been kind of my driving force to be a therapist all these years, to see where people can shift from the patterns that hold back to the life force.
I'm playing with Nick's penguins suddenly. And that community of penguins that become brave to go to the outside to experience the cold. And the inner penguins who are warm and safe in their comfort zone are able to see that. Think, hey, maybe I can go to that cold edge. Maybe I can experience that because I know this community will welcome me back in and I'll be safe. So to find that community that allows us to go to the edge and to welcomes us back in again, we can move from that comfort zone, that safety of our penguin pack, flock, I don't know what they're called, back to the edge and back in and move and be fluid in that community of moving in and out. And then to find, what is that community? Where do we find that place to build that community? We build it here, sort of, around a digital fire, but we're around the globe right now. We're not actually a huddled mass. We sit in our homes, in our suburbs, in our cities. Perhaps we only ever work from home, and we don't actually have that huddled mass around us. And that first step is to step towards that cold edge and look out. If it's not here in front of us, it must be back there on that cold edge. So that first step of building that life of inquiry, that life of connection, is to take that risk and to go to that cold edge and say, is there anybody else here? And maybe there's an answer, or maybe there isn't.
This is good. I got something I'm going to jump in with. We'll talk about penguins in a moment, but I want to invite a distinction, a three-part distinction with the lie. So the first lie is the Joseph Pieper's lie, where someone is consciously lying to someone and they know it's a lie. They're denying a slice of reality. The second distinction is what Benita gestured at, is that they're not consciously lying, but they're living a lie and they don't know better. And then the third one is what Skylar mentioned, is that like the meta-awareness that's happening. You know, it's like this is a slow unfolding of the lie, and then the lack of trust, perhaps, that comes with it, lack of self-trust or self-doubt, because your previous way to know the truth is in question itself. The methodology of truth is in question. And I think there's good reason why the conspiracy theory, everyone's becoming a conspiracy theory these days, is because there's such, like, regardless if you can analyze and disregard the propositions that a lot of people are saying that are labeled conspiracy theorists, but underneath it, the signal there is just this deep distrust. And I think that's a good reason why that's there. And when I kind of like in this third mode, it's like you go kind of crazy because you don't have anything to ground yourself with. And so this thought emerges like, who do I want to go crazy with? Who's my people that I want to go crazy with? Who are my penguins, my crazy penguins that'll take me to the edge? And I don't know if it's this configuration. I don't know if it's wise because we're all in different locations. We have different like life stories and drama, but in spirit, these are the people that I want to go crazy with. Peace back.
I have something that came up when Peter first picked up that book and started talking about honesty, and then talking about the lie now. And that is this really like uncomfortable feeling, like here, is that solar plexus somewhere here? Like a kind of vibratory. And I think it's something to do with the fact that I'm not here to speak in favor of lying, but there is something about the creative act as an artist and through what I do in ritual that is definitely not representing the truth as it is, right? Like, it's not the truth. There's something about performance and about, you know, saying the words and then hearing yourself saying them, and then something about that letting the thing come through you and come out of your mouth gives you feedback about whether it is true. And I feel like for a long time in my life, I was kind of stopping at this point because I was assessing everything and saying, is this right? Is this factually correct? Is it morally good? Is it true? Those are the two things. Is it right and is it good? These are my two questions that cycle. And I noticed there were certain people who I was around who gave me permission to say untrue, outrageous silliness. And because we had that, I don't know what it is, that pre-existing relationship that held us, and then they knew me in a very deep way, I had the ability to try on these different opinions and these different thoughts and these different way of beings. And that's how I grew. And so I love the ideal of honesty. I think it's beautiful. But for me, the way that I almost like persecuted myself with it for a long time, and lifting that criteria, blockage, whatever, and saying, no, actually, it's okay to play. It's okay. And trusting that people would hold that. And that's difficult when we talk about, because I'm talking about individual personal relationships, when we talk about the culture as a whole, I can't trust the culture to know when I'm joking. And especially when everything's so flattened online and you can't see my eyebrows and you can't, you know. But there's something in me that wants to speak for that kind of trickster energy of actually sometimes lying is important. Yeah. And I'll put the piece back with fear and trembling.
I felt so much excitement hearing Rebecca, your share. It was really resonating with something that was percolating for me after Ria's share. Like what blocks aliveness from coming out? And it's making me question this word lie, because sometimes, like you, Rebecca, I will withhold what's happening for me, a story, a theory, an emotion, because I'm not sure it's 100% correct or objectively true or fair to react that way. But that's a lie, I think. I'm not lying. It's like a kind of withholding lie. I'm lying about my aliveness. I'm hiding it rather than letting it come out. So there's almost like me having a bad take is my truth, at least, even if it's not the truth. So there's a kind of lie by omission that's really about me and what I'm thinking. It's true that I'm thinking this. It's true that I'm angry at you, but I'm hiding it. So I just wanted to jump on there. Peace down.
I think this is really good distinction. And there's something in here about the difference between the act and then the justification of the act, right? So I might take an action and I can inspect my dispositional state toward that action. So yeah, I kind of knew that I was incongruent in myself when I took that action. But sometimes we don't know because it's spontaneous or you're out of control. So you have to wait and see what the results are. And then there's actions that our dispositional states feel really solid, that we are congruent. Those don't fall in the territory of truth or lie. And it's the justification that happens afterwards that can be more or less truthful, more or less erroneous, or one of these three lies that Peter's was talking about. And I just came back from a symposium at the Monastic Academy and talking to the young people there. It's amazing in certain areas how much awareness in life is in young people's minds. But what they did have was the sense they had to justify their life. And I would say, see that robin? Does it have to justify its existence? You know, so there was this sense that, like, well, I'm eating food and taking up resources. So how can I justify that? And I think that's kind of one of these impossible pickles we put ourselves in. So, yeah.
Picking on the stick. Just doing the CP thing of going to pick it up and just have silence for a moment. Noticing how pleasant it is to watch AJ laugh like that. Just kind of, when I saw him laugh like that, it made me feel good. Felt my chest like lift like that or something. Stick that.
I wanna thanks Nick for the break. And it's just amazing how much happens in the silence. Like I wanted to speak when you spoke, when you picked up the stick. I was like, you know, working on what I was gonna say. Like I had this thing, it was like the pressure to speak was very intense. And then you called for the silence. And at first I was like, I don't wanna be silent. And then I was silent and I was like, oh, this is really nice. And it made me think about the navigation of needs in a collective space. And suddenly, like how quickly I flipped from wanting to get my point through to feeling really happy that you were getting your needs met. And maybe others, but you know, it felt like I could feel that you asked for what you needed and you took it, and it felt really good after I got through my personal discomfort. So thank you. My story is kind of irrelevant now.
It was funny because I experienced the same thing, Skylar, when the silence, Nick dropped the silence bomb. And what I wanted to share was one of my favorite actors, Klaus Kinski, which happens to be one of Benita's favorite actors. The quote that he says that I absolutely love is, I don't need anyone to tell me how to be alive. I don't need anyone to tell me how to be alive. And I just love that quote because that's sort of like how I operate. But the thought that came up when I just, that quote came to mind is that Kinski, if you know his story, he did a lot of harm to people. He created a lot of suffering in his life. And I believe that he lived aliveness, but he did so without kind of in consideration or in relationship. So yeah, this is an interesting thing that's emerging. It's like, I think whatever this culture that wants to be birthed, it needs to honor our aliveness. But also being sensible of expressing aliveness in relationship to others, and all what can ripple out from that.
I also had the feeling of humor, the blessing of laughing at the silence bomb. It was really humorous and wonderful in the reaction, Schulier's reaction to it. And in that humor, as a necessary condition, as part of the truth telling, kind of the trickster energy of kind of needing to work through our insanity to get more sane in some kind of a way, and to be held by a community that supports that, feel that very strongly. And what I was feeling earlier was a sense of integrity. Someone came up in like all caps, integrity, and integer, the root of that word, of wholeness, of being whole, in the sense of separating where I'm doing this in this situation as a kind of separation from ourselves and away from our integrity and that kind of a lie. And so the challenge and condition of integrity or working on that sense of wholeness, which is nice, like the penguin of the self, where we have like a warm core and working around that. And I'm excited and yielding back peace.
I love the idea of every individual being a community of penguins. And I think to go with that, the edge, the penguins at the edge of my community of penguins, my interior community of penguins, are facing something like the unknown. And I think what they get from facing the unknown is like just, oh, I heard the art critic Susie Gablick calls it the methodology of the marvelous, like just random synchronous stuff that just comes. So you have to be on the edge to see it, because if you're in the middle, you only see the other penguins. But if you're on the edge, you encounter the world in this very immediate, strange way, and things don't necessarily make sense. But that image, like the image of the penguins that just came spontaneously into our conversation, that image comes in and then it connects to something else within me and something else and something else. And that is almost like building a new, I don't know, like a new skeleton of being for me. So I think the question, how do we create a culture that does the things that you said at the beginning, maybe part of that is the openness to, like randomness, just random images and ideas and synchronicity, and taking that seriously and paying attention to it. Because if we just stay within the structure of what we've built, whether that's our own identity, our own brain, or our own community, then we're kind of like, I mean, it could be great, but it's the potential for expansion isn't there until you open yourself to the new. And the new is that stuff that seems to be completely meaningless and absurd when you first encounter it. That's the truly new stuff. Something about that, something about letting the bizarre, the marvelous into our space and into our, into our heads, I guess, into our lives, our return to peace.
Noticing the effect of Sean speaking from the floor, was some confusion about, is it just us eight versus the room? And I'm just noticing the effect on my actual body of that. I was like, whoa, I felt like I was strapped to a sail on a sailing boat, and suddenly the wind changed or something. I was like, ah, and it stretched me in a really weird shape. No negative, I'm just noticing it. I'm naming it because it's present for me. I'm just trying to say, do I go with that or resettle back in again? Or is there a new normal? I don't know where I am.
Yeah, I felt that too. And I don't know if like, oh, should I like police it and kind of state the rules, or just like let the liveness of the community burst through?
That's like always my dilemma. I feel like it's a really familiar place to be. And maybe it kind of, there's been something floating around that hasn't had enough substance yet to like speak into, but maybe I'll just bring it in, which is context. I'm noticing it feels like there's like an abstraction, like there's a level of abstraction that we have here so that we can all, well, I don't know about so that, but I feel it's helpful that I can speak into the abstraction a little bit. Like we're talking about communication, or community or inquiry, but like in my day-to-day life, there are moments when absurdity or spontaneity are welcome, and there are moments when it's actually not gonna serve. And noticing, like I was just at an event over the, a few days ago, that was really, and it touches me because it was a group of people performing an act of great importance that required a lot of precision. And their way of managing that was to use a kind of like militaristic, it was like lockstep. Like they had to, you know, do the actions together, and the timing was really important. And I was noticing how hard it was for me to join in because I'm so committed to, or even used to, more emergence. And I had a judgment at first about that precision and the way they were enacting what they had to do. And it was, again, I guess this is the theme for me right now, just coming off of these big experiences I've just had, is humility. Because there's a time and a place also for inquiry, I think, and a time and a place for just doing the job that needs to be done. And I think that's an interesting inquiry.
I feel like there's something here about the balance between structure and anti-structure, and like regulating those and allowing us to, and it's difficult because you have to sense what's appropriate when, and you pick up on that obviously by tuning in to the other people in the group, and the further away you are from them and the less sense information you have about that, the harder. But I think in a community that's like functioning in a sort of beautiful, organic way that lets everyone grow, there, like you say, there are moments for opening up and moments for coming in. And there would be, everyone's at a different stage in that. It's almost like it's like we're all breathing together. And then we're all breathing individually, but then as a group, we're all breathing together in and out, opening up and then moving into more structured behavior. And of course, I think of rituals and the way that rituals do this for people. And when you're talking about, Skylar, when you're talking about the people doing everything in synchronicity very carefully, I'm thinking, that's what I love. Give me some prostrations with my bros, like get into sync, feel that kind of group mind emerging as we move together. And like from the outside, that could look terribly robotic and forced. But there's a weird freedom that comes with submitting to that pattern, to those ancient rhythms. But of course, you don't want to become trapped in them. So like, I think this is a tension that every community and every individual is constantly struggling with, the tension between structure and anti-structure. And I think the dream would be to have some kind of perfect flow and movement where you're coming in and out, but this doesn't seem like it's going to be possible in this lifetime for us. And I think perhaps just being aware of it and able to surf it a little bit is a good goal. At least that's kind of what I'm aiming for when I interact with people. And I'll put the piece back.
I think this is an important move. And that, I mean, what Rebecca's saying, and maybe it's not a question of, I mean, it is a question of structure and anti-structure and power and anti-power and bottom-up and top-down, but it's coming up for me and that feels very alive. It's I think it's also a question of open or closed. That we have 8 people here that really don't know each other. We don't live with each other. There's a sense of reaching for intimacy, but it doesn't really exist. And so can a question like we've posed be solved by an open, I mean, the assumption is we just keep opening and opening and opening conversations. And I'm wondering if this is a limiting assumption for actually creating a culture of inquiry that is more alive, perhaps. Perhaps we've just assumed that the globalization, social globalization, is the way. I don't know. I think it's an interesting question.
Yeah, picking up somehow something related with that. Somehow in that metaphor of the penguins, as far as I remember that documentary, they were like taking care of the eggs or the little ones. And to me, it feels as if in this time, more than 3.5 years ago, it seems like there's also a movement of looking out, not just looking in into the circle and into the own network, and but kind of into the world. And now what do we do? Now, how to bring whatever capacities we have grown and seeds of culture we are creating and cultivating. What do we do? How do we engage that with the world? And how to navigate then, not just in our own little circle, let's say, but something that has both something of the new culture we create and engaging with outside. I'm not sure I'm expressing well, but and then the culture of inquiry is maybe just a part of the culture, and the culture needs to be expanded into other things also. Please back.
I'll pick up. What's alive for me after the last two shares is a kind of journey I've been on over the pandemic. The Stoa really represented for me, to some extent, finding my people. These are the people I've been looking for. Like, these are the people I want to connect to and talk with. Like, they kind of, like, we all kind of got something about each other. But as the time has gone on, I've started to see, like, but I don't live in the Stoa. And there are these people that live right below me and all around me. And there's people in my life, like, on the regular. And I'm almost, to some extent, a little bit, I realized I was neglecting them to be with my digital people. And so now I'm really on this turning, kind of like I'm hearing from Ria, of like, okay, how do I take this to the people on the subway, to the person at the corner store? Like, that's what I think I'm really longing for now, is to, like, spread it, germinate it, create it, cultivate it, bring it all the time, something like that. And I'm not even sure what it is, but some quality that I need to be cultivating everywhere. Peace back.
Wow. Thanks, AJ. I really resonate with that, and I saw a lot of nodding. There's something that so many paradoxes, right? So many paradoxes, and what came to mind? Well, I've lost. It's like interesting. I just went into like a really spacey space. You were talking about making it something very concrete, and the paradox just expanded me. I went whoop in both directions, and I was like with you, with my neighbors and my community, and then also, and I think it was that statement about your digital people or virtual people, and my heart starts beating, because like for me also, that it's like, where are we talking about connecting? Because there's no distance between us. There's really no distance. It is true, we don't live together. I feel a little sadness about that for some reason too. We don't live together. I would love to live with y'all, but we don't. But at the same time, there is access. I do have access to a kind of intimacy, different kinds of intimacy. And I've come to learn over the last few years that I, like, that's one of my gifts is an intimacy, a disembodied energy, which is actually really embodied, but a virtual or a subtle kind of intimacy that I think is really important, that we make that a reality too, that we don't, it's like, I want to hold both, I guess. I want to hold both. Hold on, there's like a lot of energy with me right now, so. Yeah, I think it comes down to one of the, like on the edge, like as a penguin on the edge, I also see that we're not alone. Where are we taking our, you know, where, what, who are you following? What are you following? Like, where are you getting your instruction? And for me, it's a lot of unseen forces, beings. I'm right now trying to work out some of that, and it feels like that's very, I feel very on the edge sometimes with that, and it requires a lot of inquiry, but also a lot of holding in community. And I need a community like this, whether we live together and I shop at the, you know, it's not my, like my corner deli person isn't going to hold me in this inquiry. So yeah, just like stretching, I think, the boundaries, like going way and way deep into the physical, geo-local, and way into like the shamanic flying space, like the hawk or something, you know, of it all. But now we have the penguins on the ground huddled and the hawk soaring above. He's back.
Picking up the stick. Yeah, it's interesting. That's interesting that you mentioned that. This is a strong feel. I can't believe I'm saying this, but I learned in CP the thing you least want to say, say it. But I feel like Peter's room is full of things. I don't know what they are, and I don't, but I can, meaning invisible things. And I'm just like, what the fuck's all that stuff behind? I don't mean objects, I mean energies like that. It just lit up like that when we were talking a minute ago. And I'm like, what's there? I don't know. I'm just saying my perception, but it feels non-ordinary. That's my experience now of it in this moment. And all my energies and my eyes and everything are drawn towards Peter's Square. And I'm just like, what's there in that room? What is it like that? That's my feeling.
When AJ said, "Here's my people," kind of, I lit up a little bit, because it's about finding your people, and that's what this is about, is finding that community. And we're just a raft of penguins right now. I think somebody has to take a drink. I saw that somewhere in there. But we never had community. That was the whole problem. We thought we had community. We thought we had community with our schools, and then we all got jobs, and that was our community. These were our friends. We could tolerate going for a coffee with some of these people, but it wasn't community. And then this pandemic thing happened, and we lost that. And so some of us went looking for something else. There has to be something. I'm all alone. I'm trapped in my house with my family, and I'm alone. And out of the ether came the Stoa, the creation of Peter. And we said, I found them. I found the others. Here they were, right here, scattered around the world. And at the same time, I was going down to the beach here in Toronto and doing Wim Hof method breath work and going for a swim in the icy waters of Lake Ontario. And I'd invite, and for years I've been doing this, years and years and years. And I'd invite people, and they'd come for a couple weeks, and they'd leave. And more would come, and they'd leave. And then during this pandemic, when we weren't allowed to be near people, and in Canada, we couldn't even associate in groups more than five outside. It was terrific. So we'd go down and break the law together. And we'd breathe together. And that was a shared experience of breathing together. And we'd go into the cold together. And at the end of this, I'd always hurry off to my car and drive home because I had to be alone in my home with my family. And it was one day that someone there said, "Where are you going? We hang out here, you know." And I said, "What?" And so I stopped and I sat down after the breath work and the cold exposure. And we sat down and people brought out snacks, cookies and chocolate. And I sat with the others. And just like AJ said, here's my people. I realized that here's my people. I had this community that was there already. But I was so inwardly focused on that raft of penguins, just looking inwards. I hadn't stepped to the edge of that cold, the cold edge yet. And by just taking that moment and saying, okay, I'm going to stay here on this cold edge with these people who are doing this thing that I actually created. I didn't create the Wim Hof method. I created the community of people in Toronto doing it. And there was this community suddenly. And then it grew. And it grew. And it grew. And now we have 20, 30, 50 people showing up, sharing this experience of breathwork and cold exposure. And it's not just that. It's a community of people who are inquiring about how to be people. About how to break away from 9 to 5, home, watch Netflix, drink a bottle of wine, go to bed, get up and do it again. It's suddenly this group of people that want more. And we hold each other accountable and we see each other in them. It's a true community of seeing each other and to be seen. And it's in that state of vulnerability of being seen that you are truly with the others. And I keep seeing in the chat about how do we do this? How do we create that community of inquiry, that life of inquiry? How do we do it? This is a beautiful community where we talk about how to do it. But how do we actually go to the cold edge and do it? And I think in there somewhere is finding the awareness of whether or not you are doing it. If you're trying to do it, it's something that you'll always be striving for, but are you doing it now? Are you in the moment living this life that we are talking about? Not just talking about it, but actually in this moment, are you doing it? And then to be aware that you are. And there's a big moment of surrender and a big moment of vulnerability. And to discover that your strength is in that vulnerability.
Picking it up, it seems to me, maybe it is for me, the scary thing about moving out into the world, or let's say opening our circle of people, is what somehow Skylar was pointing to, like that the world and life is more than just about the people. I mean, there's a whole dimensions and energies and nature and animals and flowers and the bizarre and whatever, that we, all of us in some way, I think, kind of integrate in artwork, in making mandalas, in you name it, the demon, whatever word we use, intuition, and to kind of, I would say, stand for that or integrate that while engaging with the world outside. Yeah, that seems to be at least what I notice in many people, like, whoa, can we do that? Can I take the message from the drawing I just made and act on it or stand for it or? I just want to mention, let's say we have 5 or 8 minutes left for kind of closure, and then we hand over to the button.
This song has been going around in my head, and the repeating line, the refrain or whatever, is, "Oh Lord, don't let me be misunderstood." It just, like the last couple of shares, that song has come in and it's just going through my head. And I think the question of how do we create this culture and what can we do? And maybe this sounds abstract, but it feels really, I don't know, important to say. Maybe we should allow ourselves to be misunderstood. Maybe that is, like Nick was talking about, the presences behind Peter, and there are presences behind all of us, like metaphorically. We're all this mad mix-up mess of stuff, of personal history, you know, everything. And there is no way that any of you or anyone, no matter how close to me they are, is going to fully understand me. And that has to be okay, because it is the state of reality, and I'm not going to understand me. And maybe if we could just let go of that desire, and I don't know how to do this, but if we could let go of that desire to be understood, because being seen is good, but being seen perfectly is impossible. And if we ask for that, if we want that from the world, then we are going to be just so disappointed. So yeah, and maybe there's opportunities for growth in those misunderstandings. Maybe you misunderstand me, but in a way, you know, you understand some part of me that I don't understand. So it's all a wash. So that's my thought about how we do this. When you go to speak or interact with people, don't make your goal to be perfectly understood. Maybe there's some other goal that one of you guys has come up with that might be good, but being perfectly understood is a terrible goal. I'm putting the piece back.
Pick it up. Something about performance keeps coming back in related to that spell casting that Rebecca was talking about earlier. And I felt kind of clear on what we were performing for a bit in the beginning of this inquiry. And then when Nick did his silent pause and then Sean jumped in and I got disrupted, I'm like, I don't know what I'm performing right now. I got a little confused. And I'm reminded about AJ's share about him being drawn more to people online than in person, but being called. And I think we all share that to a degree. And part of it is I don't like vibe with people's performances, the persona. It feels just like so limited, like the room that they get to play. And I vibe with the people's personas or people's performances here. And I don't think we can escape performance. And so it's like almost as the performances might have to get wilder. And be more wild. And it's almost like, you know, what spell are you casting? That the notion of performative utterance is like you're not just saying what reality is, you're sort of bringing about it. And so I'm leaving right now. It's like, what's my performance right now? And what spell do I want to cast with you all? He's back.
I'm just sitting here feeling like maybe in the culture, a culture of inquiry is an outcome. Like felt backwards, the inquiry, like, oh, let's define what a culture of inquiry is and then figure, and then how. It's like a outcome of how we do things and whatever, you know, what we're called to do will be different, each of us, you know. So this is like, for me, suddenly it felt like, and maybe Peter, this is a little to your point, I was also sort of becoming aware that I wasn't sure what I was performing, and which was fine. But it's like, this feels like a culture of inquiry. We're inquiring about, we're a culture of inquiry. The Stoa is a culture of inquiry. That's what I feel like I'm doing here a lot of times. So, and it feels like it's the essence of the Stoa, right? I mean, this is like my ignorance of Greek history, but the Greeks did that pretty well. Really well. And that essence has come through, like is carried through this transmission. And so when I show up here, I'm doing something with you, and that is inquiry. That's it for now.
Just wondering if you want to have some closing thoughts, Bonnie. Pretty silent.
Yeah, a lot of things are coming up with me, but there's the time thing. So I just will pass. Thank you.
I guess it's time for you, Rebecca, to do the closing ritual.
Oof, okay. Moving back into structure. Lovely structure. yeah, we're coming to the end of the session and the end of the Stoa, at least in this form. And here we are, brought beautifully into the present moment by breath. And by this mindful conversation, which has brought me to a different level. And you can tell, obviously, the difference in how I started this session and the way I was speaking and the nerves. And then after that experience, coming down into myself and feeling more like I'm with you people, because I am. So since we're here in the present moment, let's put an X on the map of this present moment by putting our hands on our hearts like this. And we'll do my favorite little breathwork thing that I made up. We're gonna think, I'm on the inhale and here on the exhale. We're gonna take three big-
Your mic is covered.
Oh no. Okay, we'll go a little bit lower. yeah, so we're gonna think, I'm on the inhale and here on the exhale, and take three big, deep breaths together with the intention of, as I say, putting the cross on the map, the you are here cross of this moment. So all together, I'm here. Ooh. And again, I'm here on the exhale. One more time, all together. I'm here on the exhale. You are here. I mean, you're there in front of your screen in a certain position in space, but you're here in this conceptual space that we call the Stoa, and we are all here in this moment of time. And the ritual that I'm going to talk us through is all about time, and it's inspired by those thoughts that you have about time when you're stoned or have been reading too much Kant. So it's like, is time real, or is it just a way we interact with the world? Are we all existing in the present moment, really, if you get down to it? And this is all just made up, this linear narrative of time. So we're going to indulge that train of thought. If time isn't real, then 3 years ago is now. And Peter and I are meeting for the first time in Athens. And Peter's uploading the first Stoa video, and everything is happening all at once in the present moment. And if that's true, what's true anyway, that's a whole different discussion. Maybe through ritual, we can create a sort of imaginal portal back to the beginning. So this is a ritual thought experiment, and it's as real as you want it to be. It could be performance, or you could really live into it. That's the beauty of ritual. So many possibilities. I'm going to invite you to tread the wheel backwards in time. So if everyone could just close their eyes, take another deep breath and roll your eyes back in your head as if you're looking up at your forehead. If you feel a rush, it means it's working and we're traveling back in time. It's last Wednesday, the summer solstice. Here in the Northern Hemisphere, that was the longest day and the shortest night. And I just want you to think, what were you doing? Who were you with? Who were you last Wednesday? Okay, take another deep breath and roll your eyes back in your head again. And we're at the spring equinox at the end of last March. What was going on for you at that moment? End of last March. It's not that long ago, really. Can you remember what you were doing? Okay, another deep breath and roll your eyes back in your head again and imagine all the fresh green shoots of spring rewinding back down into the ground. It's the winter solstice. The shortest day and longest night, just before last Christmas. What were you doing then? What were you thinking about? Okay, again, time travelers disorienting. Take a deep breath, throw your eyes back in your head, and imagine the rotting leaves on the ground turning golden and levitating back up onto the trees. It's the autumn equinox, end of September 2022. Where were you? It's trickier for some of us than others. Okay, let's keep going. Take a deep breath. Roll your eyes back in your head. Imagine the orange leaves reanimated as the chlorophyll floods back in, turning them green. And it's the summer solstice. Everything's green. It's the end of June 2021, just over a year ago. Sorry. I skipped around a bit. Sorry, it's June 2022, just over a year ago. Are we there? Are we there? Not for long. Take a deep breath, roll your eyes back in your head. And we're headed to the spring equinox, end of March 2022. Who were you then? End of March 2022, last year. Okay, take a deep breath, roll your eyes back. And we're going to step that wheel a little bit faster now in reverse. Winter solstice 2021, just before Christmas 2021. Just any memory, even if it doesn't seem right, just hold on to that memory and then breathe and roll your eyes back to autumn equinox 2021. It's the end of September 2021. Any memory, any feeling, anything? Let's keep going, breathe and roll. Summer solstice 2021, everything's green again. Breathe and roll. Here we're at the spring equinox, March 2021. In the UK, our lockdown was just ending, beginning to lift. Here at the Stoa, we had maybe the end of the Stoa party. Who were you then in March 2021? Any little scrap of that time. And then we're going to breathe and roll back. There was an election in America, apparently a big deal. And then we're at winter solstice 2020, Christmas in lockdown. Breathe and roll, autumn equinox 2020. Breathe, roll. Summer solstice 2020, just starting that long, hot summer, we were all locked in. Breathe and roll. And we're in spring equinox, late March 2020, and we're here at the beginning of the Stoa, 3 years ago. Can you imagine yourself 3 years ago? What were your concerns? What were your hopes? What were you wearing? What was your facial hair situation? Can you try and conjure up an image of yourself 3 years ago and think about the difference between you looking at that past self? How have you changed internally, externally? How far have you come? How far have we come together? Now imagine you could talk to them, that you could send one sentence through the time portal that we've just created back to March 2020. What would you say? I'll give you a moment to think. Okay, when you're open, when you're ready, I want you to open your eyes and write that sentence in the chat. And just everyone write something. It doesn't have to be profound. It could be a quote, a song lyric. Don't miss this chance to communicate with the past. And I'm going to ask Steve, Ria, Shyla, Nick, Benita, and Peter to share their messages. But I'll go first. In the spirit of being honest, I didn't prepare anything, even though I knew I was going to have to make this message. I think I'd say something like, and I know that she wouldn't listen to me, but I try nonetheless. I'd say, trust the movement. Don't try to control everything. And pay attention. That's the most important thing I've learned in the last 3 years, to pay attention. And that's what I tell her. I might give her a little shake in the hope that it would get through. Steve, what would you say to Steve of 3 years ago?
It's all going to work out.
Nice. Ria?
Trust in it.
Shyla?
Very messianic. He's coming. The one he's waiting for is coming.
Benita.
Mine was an image. So when you when you're playing tennis or baseball, this notion of following through. So instead of just cutting at it, like follow through. That action.
I love that. And Peter.
Do it. Just do it, do it, do it.
Okay, I hope everyone's had some time. Oh, AJ, I missed you. I'm so sorry. AJ, go, please.
What came up for me immediately was to say to myself, you don't need a boyfriend. And I think also there's Nick.
Nick, yeah.
I thought that was part of the sentence you were saying. I don't need a boyfriend, but also
there's Nick.
I thought that's what you were saying. I was like, wait, I didn't see that coming. In 2020. Mine would be, you know, imagine you're going to die tomorrow, and like, what would you do today? Do that.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm like a duck. I can only count to six. So, yeah, I hope everyone else has put their messages in the chat, because it makes sense. If we can send messages back 3 years in the past, then our future selves, 2026 people, surely could send messages to us. And I think if we're playing this little game, perhaps those messages will come from each other's messages. So what I want you to do, what I want everyone to do, is open the chat and just have a scroll through. And the first message that your eyes are light on, treat that as if it was a message from your future self. And maybe it won't make sense because we change and grow, obviously. So maybe it won't make sense to you. Maybe it'll be strange. But I just want you to take that little bit of wisdom, scribble it down, type it down, however you need to record it. And yeah, treat it like something to meditate on, something to grow into. Treat it like it was genuinely a message from your future self. Don't overthink it. Just scroll and choose the first one. So you could call this divination, or chaos skimming, or just a silly little game. But yeah, remember that message. Just give everyone a moment to find their message. And then I'd really like to share my sound, but the options aren't presenting themselves exactly as I would like. Ooh, get back to your body. That feels like that was the one for me. Thank you, Kevin. That's been a big lesson that I've learned in the last 3 years. Bitcoin advice, yes. Great. Okay. So I hope everyone's found something, because I've figured out how to share my computer sound. Let's see if you guys can hear this, because I think this is a message from this strange egregore called the Stoa that we've created all together, and we've all heard it 1,000 times. But let's hear it again. And I hope you guys could hear that. So let's come back to the present moment. The portal is closing. The portal is closing. Read that message. Find your message whilst you can, because we're about to close it by putting our hands on our hearts, trying not to block our microphones, and thinking, I'm on the inhale, big inhale together. And here on the exhale. Coming back to the present, another breath. I'm on the inhale. Here on the exhale. One last breath together. I'm on the inhale. Here on the exhale. And again, I'm here, you are here, we are here, And before we blow out our candles, maybe Peter would like to say goodbye.
That was beautiful. That's what I needed. So thank you. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, Steve. Thank you, Ria, Skylar, Benita, AJ, Nick, and everyone who came out today and everyone who's watching. Stoa is always ending, but it's just beginning. So if you'd like to keep up to date with things, the best place would be the Substack, Less Foolish. We have this wonderful practice at the Stoa, now at Less Foolish, called collective journaling, where we journal every morning. We engage in inquiry with ourselves together in a Zoom room. Holly did a passage that I wanted to share. I thought it was quite lovely, and I'll read it out. The Stoa, the steward, a place, the sage on the stage. Life is a constant process of disassembling and reassembling all the many pieces. A thought experiment. What if Peter hasn't been the steward of this place? What if all of us were the stewards, and he was the one we were stewarding? What if we were the spiritual bouncers guarding and shaping this place, and Peter was the one in the club getting high on the wisdom lace thumos, which is true. What if this whole time we were the sages on the stage? What if we were teaching the sage how to speak, how to think, how to listen, how to be sage? What if the fools in the commons that created the sage? What if I got more sleep and my journal entries were better? Regardless, the generativity of this thought experiment, all I know is that I'm so grateful for this place, whatever its name may be, this body of all of us, and so grateful to participate in and bear witness to its disassembly and reassembly. It feels rich and good in my body. Amen.
Oh, well, I guess it's that time. If everyone brings their candles up. And after we blow out our candles, I'm going to play us out with a song, or attempt to. So there'll be a chance to say goodbye and wave goodbye in the chat, and maybe have a dance if you feel like it. But yeah, thinking about how blowing out a candle is one of the, you know, the rituals that we all know and love from birthdays. Perhaps we can make a wish for the future, of Less Foolish, and for all our individual futures as we sort of move in and out like penguins in this strange thing we call community. You guys want to join me now raising your candles and blowing them out?